Dear friends, thank you for joining us tonight for the first talk of our 2023 series, Entre Nous. As those of you who are familiar with the series may recall, Entre Nous is a collaboration between the American Library in Paris, Columbia Global Centers Paris, and the Institute for Ideas and Imagination. The objective of this partnership, created in the midst of a global pandemic in 2021, is to open up to the world and challenge our minds by creating personable encounters with some of the leading scholars, journalists, and artists from our networks around the world to share their views and expertise on topics that matter on a global scale. As such, we have had fascinating conversations on such varied topics as climate change, social justice, diaspora, and identity. The series also has had the honor of having a certain number of artists who question their artistic practice and transgress traditional norms. Amongst the many distinguished speakers we have had, one whose work and spirit truly embody this idea of transdisciplinary curiosity is Robert O'Mealy, more familiarly known as Bob in his intimate circles. And Bob, since we are after all entre nous, I hope, and I asked you before and you said it was okay, that I may address you in this warm and familiar tone. So I now have the difficult task of introducing you and the great diversity of your scholarly work. To begin, you are the Zora Neale Hurston Professor of English and Comparative Literature at Columbia University. And in our little chat before, we have established that you have been at Columbia University for 34 years. You're also the founder and director of Columbia's Center for Jazz Studies. You have devoted numerous works to Ralph Ellison, Billie Holiday, and Romare Bearden. You are the co-editor of the Northern Anthology of African American Literature and editor of the Barnes & Noble editions of Mark Twain, Herman Melville, and Frederick Douglass. Your work across literature, music, and the visual arts has been recognized through your nomination as a Guggenheim and then Kallman Center Fellow at the New York Public Library, amongst other distinctions. In addition to being this distinguished scholar, you're also so very cool. And this is a direct quotation from former students of yours who cannot believe that they have had a faculty member who was nominated for a Grammy Award. You're actually so cool that this is the second time we are inviting you in our series. The last time was in November 2021. More particularly today, we are here to learn about your newest book entitled Antagonistic Cooperation, Collage, Jazz, and American Fiction, published in March 2022 by Columbia University Press. Bob, can you please explain to us how you are able to jazzify Shakespeare? That's my opening question. The floor is yours.
Well, before I address your question, I want to thank you for just the warmth of your introduction. We've been friends for quite some time, and I so appreciate my friendship with good friends there at Reed Hall and in its extensions and the American Library. But I also feel a lot of affection for the place and for the Institute for Ideas and Imagination, of which I was proud to be a part, and of the American Library in Paris, where I've also been an affiliate. And so I thank you all for making today possible. I want to thank Brune in particular, and Marie, and forgive the shorthand, if you will, as Severine. And I want to give a shout out to my friend, Velma Bourie, Velma of Montparnasse, a wonderful kind of intellectual leader and guide for so many of us. I also want to mention Paul Gilroy as a friend who's guided so many of us to think about intercontinental interdisciplinary studies. I want to talk about Severine's question of jazz and Shakespeare, and I'm trying to reach toward an understanding of what Ellington had in mind. And honestly, I think that when he presented his Ellington Shakespeare concert, his idea was quite simply to give you everything that you came for, and then more, to include the part that you might have forgotten to ask for, but which you wanted also. He gives you a lot more than you might have expected, and I'll be getting at that through the talk today. This is entre nous, onto all the correspondents that have been named, but most specifically, it's a conversation between me and the composer, Courtney Bryan. Courtney couldn't be here today. She's playing a concert back in New Orleans. But she was very kind to agree to let me interview her a bit, so there'll be some back and forth with her. And also she was kind to record her presentation of part of this Ellington piece, Such Sweet Thunder, the Shakespearean suite. Courtney is a native of New Orleans who came to Columbia University as a graduate student to study composition with the great George Lewis and with others on our spectacular music faculty. She was affiliated from the beginning with the jazz study group faculty and graduate student members. And she was a presence for so many of us, where we'd see her playing here and see her playing there, and where we would have a chance to watch her grow as a composer. She now teaches at Tulane University, and she's been celebrated far beyond that campus and beyond our shores. She was a Prix de Rome fellow, performing then in Rome and elsewhere in Europe. She's been a regular now at jazz festivals and also at festivals beyond category, writing string quartets, writing for a symphony, and also playing for her church. She manages to be a multilingual in the musical sense. And what a kind, gentle, intellectual giant and artist that she is. She's so nice. You'll feel the warmth of her presence. And so I'm delighted to share the spotlight with her today. By way of answering Severine's question, let me just play a few bars of Such Sweet Thunder. When Ellington would introduce the piece, as we'll see him do in a minute, he would sit at the piano and he would do this. We'll just hear a few bars of it to get us started. Yep. We'll hear this come up later. Forgive me, Duke, for cutting you short. This is his introduction to the suite, and it's, in a sense, Othello walking on stage, or Othello giving his first speech, as you'll hear more about in a moment. This is a talk in search of a thesis, if a talk needs a thesis. Maybe it's something about antagonistic cooperation, the kind of interaction between a musician and a work of poetry or drama. Antagonistic cooperation. It's not exactly emulation and it's not exactly fighting, but trying to find common ground and trying to learn something and trying to outdo and trying to create something new. Maybe unruly Black cosmopolitanism plays a part in it. That's a key phrase in my book as I try to look at Bearden and Toni Morrison and others as people who were outside the regulations, the usual lines of things, as they tried to define a larger sense of what it meant to be African American. Here's Courtney. You can see her Christmas tree in the background. That was just a week ago. Before she comes on here, she apologized for still having her tree up. And she was telling me that she played this piece. She played three sections of it at a great club in New Orleans called Snug Harbor. So that's interesting. She's playing it at a jazz club. And I asked her, you know, what was the setup at that club that night?
Well, I started with Alice Coltrane, but then I played the Billy Strayhorn Ellington set, and then I went into my newest piece, my piano concerto. I wrote arranged a small version for a string quintet so I could play through it.
Were you solo?
Yeah. Well, no, I was solo. I started off solo, and then I
antagonist
had
to cooperate. It's not exactly emulation. It's not exactly fighting. But trying to find common ground and trying to learn something and trying to outdo and trying to.
And for the string, did you play
new.
These three or did
maybe
you,
unruly black cosmopolitanism plays a part
that
in
piece.
It. That's a key phrase.
Yeah, so that's what I did. Look
at Bearden.
I didn't know
Tony
what I was
going to
do at Madison Great Ones, because that's the one that's been most challenging. So I just kind of had those parts
the usual
of it.
Lines of
just kind of influence of it. Kind of instead of being as open as
what it meant to be.
I want to, but I wanted to do more with it. But I felt comfortable with Sister Kate playing it straight, and then I felt comfortable playing Star-Crossed Lovers. So I just kind of saw what happened, you know, at the set.
So we'll see that soon. She plays those three pieces, a sonnet for Sister Kate about the Taming of the Shrew, Madness and Great Ones about Hamlet, and then Star-Crossed Lovers about the Song of Juliet. That's what she's referring to there. So what is this all about? There's a concert, 1956 and 57, by Ellington and his writing companion Strayhorn, which he said was written to parallel the world of William Shakespeare. And that word parallel is important here. He said he's not adapting, he's not doing incidental music, he's not doing a soundtrack, he's doing his own thing that comments on what Shakespeare had to do as a parallel creation toe-to-toe. Strayhorn, as I say, his writing companion, whom you see at right, had recently rejoined the band and was very excited about doing big band projects, concert works. And this is one of several. If you look up the Ellington Strayhorn book, you'll see that in the mid to late 50s, they're doing a lot of big pieces. Strayhorn in the band was called Sweet Pea because he was so little. It's like it's this little 5'2", I believe it is. But he was also called Shakespeare. He liked to sit on the complete Shakespeare that he had with him. And he said he always felt like a bigger man when he had Shakespeare, a little Shakespeare underneath him. He was a great composer. And I think we're going to just hear more about him as time goes on. My colleague, David Hadju, is working on a movie about, Strayhorn's biographer, who has a documentary movie in the making about him. What did they have in common, Severine, Ellington and Shakespeare? Well, for one thing, Shakespeare, as we know, wrote for specific players and played beside them on stage himself. So did Ellington, less so Strayhorn. But they're writing for specific people who were in the band over many, many years. When I worked on that Norton anthology you heard about, we kept trying to get Shakespeare in there. There's a longstanding rumor that Shakespeare was black. And Skip Gates said, if you give me one shred of evidence, then we'll put him all through the Norton anthology. And he doesn't belong there really, but he's very important to Harlemites. He's played well, the Shakespeare readings and plays have played well in the Harlems of America all the way from the beginning. And as you'll see, back to the 19th century. For one piece that Strayhorn wrote from Midsummer Night's Dream, the score shows that he said, okay, I'm going to make this character will be played by this horn. This character will be played by that horn. Clark Terry in the upper right hand corner was assigned the role of the fool or the wise jester, Puck. And it's interesting to look at his score. Ellington said, you can say anything you want in the trombone. You got to be careful with words. And yet he's straddling this world between words and music. At a certain point in the score, he is telling Clark, whose name is at the top of the score here, that he wants things played note for note, but at a certain point he wants his fiddle and his clarinet to be answered by the trumpet, the reeds to be answered by the trumpet. And then further down, we learn that at a certain point in his score, he says, note, the trumpet plays the quotation, Lord, what fools ye mortals be. And on Clark's own score, he's told to ad lib at first, and then he's told to play using half valves on the flugelhorn, Lord, what fools ye mortals be. Let's listen to him do it. Here it comes now. The words in the project are very important, and the titles, the introductions that Ellington gave when he was presenting the work. And we might ask ourselves, what was he trying to say? What, as Severine asked, what did Shakespeare have to do with these Black composers at mid-century? What was the sweet thunder trying to convey in words and music? I want to take a moment and talk about last year's project, the Such Sweet Thunder Year at Columbia. Our Center for Jazz Studies, working with many other parts of the campus, English Department, Humanities Center, Music, and many others, put together a series of programs. We worked with the core curriculum people to make the point that every first year student is reading Shakespeare. Let's make it Othello, since that's the one that Ellington referred to. Let's make Ellington the jazz composer of the year. And so we had master classes led by our jazz faculty on Ellington and on a Shakespeare as interpreted by Ellington and Strayhorn. We were very, very lucky. And by the way, if you go online and you can look up Such Sweet Thunder at columbia.edu and you'll see all of this. You can hear the music and see this programming that we put together. For the philosophy section of the core curriculum, we were reminded that Du Bois had said, I sit with Shakespeare and he winces not, he says in Souls of Black Folk. And so we were thinking about Shakespeare and in these various contexts. We brought a big band in led by John Faddis and featuring youngsters as well as old veterans playing the music. We got the scores that you'll see from the left, at the left, from the Library of from the Smithsonian, where Ellington's scores are kept. And there again, you can see they're written for specific people. Mad at the bottom here, the piece that Hamlet piece at that point was called Mad, and it was written specifically for Carney. The middle piece, Lady Mac, is his tribute to Lady Macbeth, and it was great fun to hear the music played so well by that band. We learned along the way from my colleague Kim Hall at Barnard that Frederick Douglass had liked to play Shakespeare. He stopped doing it because he was a leader in politics and he didn't want people confused, but he had been a small theater actor and a very, very good one. And he kept a picture of Othello in his office over the years. And so we managed, working with June Cross on our campus and the great Keith David, the actor, to bring a play to Harlem stage about Douglass using Shakespeare as a way to grow up in his speech making and writing and in his sense of what it meant to be fully human. What we learn is that Douglass quotes Shakespeare all through this first autobiography and then through speech after speech after speech and the other autobiographies as well. We brought three great Shakespearean actors to come in and talk about playing Othello. They were at Miller Theater and then the 92nd Street Y. One of them, Andre Holland, said he'd played Othello a few times, he would never do it again. He said there was no way to avoid the impression that you, a black man gets involved in a white woman, he's going to kill her. That shorthand, he felt he was entertaining racists. John Douglas Thompson said he'd played Shakespeare 7 or 8 times, and he would play, he's the one on the right here, he would play it 7 or 8 more times. He thought it was the greatest work in the English language. So it was interesting to have them talk about their roles here and how they thought about the plays. Chris Ofili was kind to let us present a dozen of his etchings of Othello. He did this tearful man who had a sign of a laugh on his face as well. And so those were in Wallet Gallery, one of our partners in this effort. We had a dance program involving Columbia students and Harlem School of the Arts youngsters. This was a special hit to demonstrate our kinship with our friends and neighbors at Harlem. Toni Morrison wrote a response to Othello. Some of you know this. She wrote a play called Desdemona, and she left out Iago. She said, "Brother Iago has got too much to say. We're going to leave him out." And it's just the conversation among the women now, including an African woman who Desdemona refers to. It's really a wonderful play, and these three scholars, Farrah Griffin, Jean Howard, Rebecca Kavanaugh, this did a terrific job talking about them. We had a listening session. There's Courtney in the red with Brent Edwards, Nicole Mitchell. That was a highlight of our season. And so back to the thing itself, the work itself, by calling it a suite, Ellington announces that there's going to be a playful sense of language used here. He's referring to the words that Othello used to explain how he wooed Desdemona, but the use of the word suite there signals that there's something more. Fred Moten said he found something festive in Othello's sweet and swinging line, something slightly mocking, something puckish, one might say. And so that's part of what, as I look for a thesis, there's something in the antagonistic cooperation with Shakespeare, between Shakespeare and Ellington, that has to do with humor that I think is quite important. James Earl Jones was invited to the White House and decided to read the speech by Othello. But he started his talk with a joke. That's not going to be included here. You can look this up online quite easily. James Earl Jones at the White House. He said, when I was invited to the White House, I was going to read Dr. Seuss or Green Eggs and Ham by Dr. Seuss, but I thought I would stick with Shakespeare. And then you watch the transformation of the man telling this joke to the one who's Othello in the court defending himself. Desdemona's father has complained that this black man has worked magic to steal away his daughter, who's white, of course. And here's what Othello says in response to that.
Most potent, grave, and reverend signors, my very noble and approved good masters, that I have taken away this good man's daughter, it is most true. True. I've married her. The very head and front of my offending at this is not normal. Rude am I in my speech and little blessed with a soft phrase of peace, for since these arms of mine had 7 years' pith, so now some 9 moons wasted, they have used their dearest action in the tented field, and little of this great world can I speak more than pertains to feats of broil and battle, and therefore little shall I grace my cause in speaking for myself. Yet by your gracious patience, I will a round unvarnished tale deliver of my whole course of love. What drugs, what charms, what conjuration, and what mighty magic for such proceeding I am charged withal.
How wonderful to see Obama's daughters there, to see the others in the group assemble to listen to this speech. It's this speech, I think, that Ellington is translating or paralleling in his opening piece for Such Sweet Thunder. It's framed as a blues. And I asked Courtney a little bit about that, and she said there's a swagger in the step of that opening piece. We heard a little bit of it at the top. Here's Courtney talking about it.
I love that Nicole Mitchell mentioned, you know, the idea of swagger. Like, it's the best way to describe that line that comes in. And I love that. I was trying to imagine if I were in the audience of the Shakespeare Festival, you know, hearing this music inspired by Shakespeare, and the first thing you hear is that, like, really soulful line that comes in, and it's the blues. So everything is rooted from the blues, and, you know, starts from there. So yeah, just that piece is just so powerful. And also this kind of like going back between the minor and the major, like in the melody, but then also like as we heard the saxophones do their solo, it's just like the harmony, it keeps doing this kind of play between, but it seems to go into that the bravado.
The bravado and the vulnerability too, because he was enslaved at one point, he suffered a lot, and he's telling her this story of his bravery, his deeds, and then his suffering. And it's the whole piece, the whole part of Othello that she's so attracted to.
There's Jean Howard, the Shakespearean, June Cross sitting next to her, John Faddis also on stage with us. But it's significant to me that it opens with the blues, and there are blues dimensions to every single piece of this, some of them outright blues and others just hinting at a little bluing in the wash of what's being played. We also get layers of rhythm in this piece that we'll hear in just a moment. I wrote to Courtney about it. Before we get to that, here's Albert Murray, who is Ellington's friend, reminds us that the blues are party music. They're music that talk about love and trouble, but they're also dance music. And the slower the trouble, more trouble there is, the more festive it can become if you're dancing with the right person. So anyway, I wrote to Courtney and I said, hey, is it true that this is a tango? Robert Ferris Thompson had said, this is a tango beat that we're hearing, that doom, da doom, doom, doom. And Courtney wrote, she said, yeah, tango, I could see that. Or Jelly Roll Morton's Spanish Tinge or Afro Habanera rhythm, as in Jelly's piece, the Crave, though technically that uses more directly the related bambula or tresillo rhythm of long, long, short in the left hand more than a habanera, long, short, short, short. Though I guess tango and habanera share that same rhythm with somewhat different inflections. The point I want to leave here with is that it's all of that. It's one rhythm on top of another. And it's the tango associated with Argentina and its Afro backgrounds. It's Jelly Roll Morton with its Spanish tinge, with its Euro, Afro, Indian inflections. It's all of those things together, which I think Ellington wanted to make in his conversation with Shakespeare. It's like, let's not forget these other parts of the globe as we think about this character. Courtney also sent me this to indicate something about this polyrhythmic approach. So one rhythm on top of another. Again, much of the score is written out note for note, but I'd like you to pay special attention to this trumpet's ad-lib section. You see at the bottom of the music down here, it says ad-lib. At that point, I'm sure Ellington had read Othello's speech to his trumpet player, Cootie Williams, and asked him to ad-lib with that in mind. Please watch Ellington conducting the band by dancing in front of them, dancing out the rhythms. Notice that he sets the rhythm and then he also signals them to come in by calling to them. He'll say, ah, come on in. But watch particularly for this trumpet solo.
Several years ago, Billy Strayhorn and I did a Shakespearean suite, which is called Such Sweet Thunder. We'd like now to do the title number for you. This is taken from Othello.
I'm going to excuse me, Duke, for just one moment here. I want to try to I'll show some of the notes as we go through, but I won't be able to show them all.
Several years ago, Billy Strayhorn and I did a Shakespearean suite, which is called Such Sweet Thunder. We'd like now to do the title number for you. This is taken from Othello. It was said that Othello gave Desdemona such a sweet and swinging line of talk, and she went for it, and of course he married her. Her father objected and tried to have the marriage annulled. And when they took the case to court, why, the Duke of Venice said that he was certain that had Othello said the same thing to his daughter, she would have gone for it too, because it was such sweet thunder.
Here comes the trumpet solo.
Thank you.
it's something to think about the piece itself, but also to think about the words that go with it. Calling it Such Sweet Thunder is to quote from Midsummer Night's Dream, where that phrase comes up. Brent Edwards has argued that, or my colleague in the English department has argued that this is a comment on form, a comedy commenting on the tragedy. And I've said, I think comedy is very important to Ellington's approach here. It's also interesting that the scores show that this piece was originally called Cleo, suggesting that the swagger of this piece may have heralded the suite's other African leader from Antony and Cleopatra, who also has a section here. Courtney agreed with the composer Nicole Mitchell in what she was saying earlier, that both pieces had African-American swagger and sway. And it does seem to me that part of the answer to the question of Ellington and the Shakespeare, he Harlemizes these characters. He makes them very, very familiar and brings them into the community in a way they hadn't been before. Here's Barry Ulanoff, who taught at Barnard and who had written an important book on Ellington, commenting on Such Sweet Thunder. He said, on stage, Duke introduces each major work with a vagabond syntax, and much could be made of that phrase. Entitling a piece about Othello with a quotation from Midsummer Night's Dream, he's gone right to the root of Othello's problem. His blunt and jazz explanation is probably closer to the substance of the play than the long and involuted commentaries of most Shakespearean scholars. The music is satisfactory too, at least as fair a pass as Shakespeare as Mendelssohn and Berlioz and Tchaikovsky made, and for our time anyway, a good deal less hackneyed. Part of the Such Sweet Thunder, the suite includes what's called Sonnet in Search of Amour. And there again, the question of the music and the words together is very significant. The first one has swagger, and the next one is a kind of tender love poem, the Sonnet in Search of Amour. And of course, he's aware that it's a play on words. He's in search of love. He's in search of amour in other senses as well. Here's Brent again. He says, of course, this is an odd and somewhat convoluted way to parallel the Shakespearean texts. Since the dialogue in the plays is not in sonnet form, it is a bit like writing a book of short stories inspired by Beethoven's symphony and calling some of the stories etudes or sonatas. He knows what he's doing, though. He's commenting one form on the other, with one form commenting on the other. Strayhorn told an interviewer concerning the sonnet In Search of Amour. He said it was triple entendre because you had to decide whether we were talking about Othello or whether we were talking about love, that is amour, or whether we were talking about the moors, the Scottish lowlands, where the three witches were, you know. I wonder if it'd also be searching for a moorland, moorings, searching for stability in that sense. I'm very hesitant to make everything that everybody Black does political, but it is significant that this comes out in 1957 at a time when the laws against Black and white intermarriage were all over the country, all through the South. And there were laws also against interracial dating. Some of these laws just went down not that long ago. The national law forbidding laws against segregation, against so-called miscegenation, was passed 1965. So I think it's significant that he leads with Othello, coming a few years after the Supreme Court case that struck down segregation in the schools. And in a year of hotly contested battles in Little Rock, Arkansas, and Charlotte, North Carolina, Ellington was making a statement in his own language. Just as Shakespeare, it was against the law for Shakespeare to criticize the Queen. That was punishable by death. So he would displace things and make them long ago far away. It's Julius Caesar in Rome, it's Othello in Venice. Likewise, Ellington is using Shakespeare to offer his own indirect comment on these matters. If you want to read more about the fight against miscegenation laws. There's a book by Randall Kennedy called Interracial Intimacies, and one by Peggy Pascoe called What Comes Naturally, that tracks that history. I think this piece could be part of that story. In connection with this, notice Martin Luther King saying that jazz is explicitly political. If you think for a moment, you'll realize they take the hardest realities of life in jazz and blues and puts them into music, only to come out with some new hope or sense of triumph. This is triumphant music. I think that's part of the story here. If we ask ourselves, where did the project begin? The simple answer is it began in Stratford, Ontario, where he was invited to give a concert. But it's significant that he was invited to give it in 56 and came back in 57. There's several books about the Stratford, Ontario Shakespeare Festival. I like this little one, which points out that the festival started in 53 and was built on the town's somewhat coincidental name of Stratford. And she tells a story of how the town happens to be called after the name of Shakespeare's hometown. The idea was to save this failing railroad town with high culture. Why not make the most of the coincidence of this name by bringing in leading Shakespeareans? And so the Shakespeare Festival was begun in 53. From the beginning, there was music. As I said, Glenn Gould, who lived not far from there, was involved, and there were other Canadian musicians, and they began to invite leading musicians across the categories. Ellington came in 1956 and again in 57, and then he came quite regularly. In 56, he just played it as another one-nighter. He did, you can see his kind of hit songs and other things of interest in the program to the right here. But while he was there, he noticed that Hamlet was being played on the same bill with Billie Holiday. The next night, Hamlet on the bill alongside Jerry Mulligan. 12th night, Hamlet. And he began to say, oh my goodness, this is something more than just another one-nighter. He could see that the standards were high all around. There, Glenn Gould is playing, Rudolf Serkind is playing. There were leading jazz players along with musicians like Benjamin Britten, whose opera was presented. He noticed too that the jazz programming was set up as a kind of seminar led by jazz artists themselves, but all like Wilbur de Paris, but also by leading jazz writers and producers, including this Barry Ulanoff that I mentioned earlier, whom Duke knew because he'd worked with him on his biography. And also he knew as somebody who was a Shakespeare specialist, he taught Shakespeare at Barnard. The printed programs emphasized this teaching aspect. They were trying to teach the audiences about Shakespeare, but also what is the beginning of jazz? What is going on in jazz now? What is its history? The presentations were set up as seminars of a certain sort with ambitious extensions. So that Langston Hughes is brought up in 1958 to join a band as part of the presentation. So Ellington said, please invite me back after 56. He saw what it was, and he would, next time he'd be ready. The Ellington archive reveals this anthology, which Duke had. It doesn't reveal that anybody read that anthology. I'm sure Strayhorn was reading Shakespeare all through the years. And so Such Sweet Thunder premiered at New York Town Hall in early 57. And then came to Stratford later that year. The book shows that Ellington practiced it through the years, playing it sometimes at the AKA dance or dances, the kind of public dances, and as well as concert settings. The program notes for that early concert helped his readers see that it was, the title came from Midsummer Night's Dream. And then he explains that he's writing these sonnets. He does several sonnets here. This is the first of four sonnets included in the suite, scored to coincide with the 14-line sonnet form, the final measures foretell of tragedy. So he's literally writing these 14-line poems in music with rhyming lines alternating, and then the rhyming couplet at the end. In the press release of 57, Ellington said, somehow I suspect that if Shakespeare were alive today, he might be a jazz fan himself. He'd appreciate the team spirit and informality, the academic knowledge and humor, all the elements that go into a great jazz performance. In the suite, I'm attempting to parallel, again, the vignettes of some of Shakespearean characters in miniature, sometimes to the point of caricature. And there, I think it's important that he thinks of them as somewhat to the point of caricature. In an interview, 57, Strayhorn said, Ellington has always been intrigued by Shakespeare, because he said Shakespeare certainly knew more about people than anyone he's ever known. Duke also said that the only way Shakespeare could have known as much about people as he did was by hanging out on the corner or in the pool room. He says that if William Shakespeare were alive today, you would surely found him down at Birdland listening to jazz. Strayhorn and Jimmy Baldwin were friends. Ellington knew him too, but it was Baldwin and Strayhorn who were close. And Baldwin has an important piece about Shakespeare called Why I Stopped Hating Shakespeare. And part of that essay reads this way. He says, the greatest poet in the English language found his poetry where poetry is found, his Baldwin on Shakespeare, in the lives of the people. He could have done this only through love. I think it's simply that he walked the streets and saw them and tried not to lie about what he saw. The public streets and his private streets, which are always so mysteriously and inexorably connected. And so he's seeing an affinity between Shakespeare and his own ambitions as a writer. On this democratic note of writing about people from the high roads and the low roads, note Fred Moten's statement that Ellington's music in his book In the Break, Moten calls Ellington's music the sound of love. Now here could follow another long statement. I think the way he composed and co-composed, working for different people, drawing ideas from them, writing for soloists, anticipating what they might do, is, and also just the sheer commitment to the music, is part of what Moten meant. Back to Jimmy Baldwin for a minute. He says, I was listening very hard to jazz and hoping one day to translate it into language. And Shakespeare's bawdiness became very important to me, since bawdiness was one of the elements of jazz and revealed a tremendous loving and realistic respect for the body and that ineffable force which the body contains, which Americans have mostly lost, which I'd experienced only among Negroes, and which I had been taught to be ashamed. So that word body, meaning funky body, sexual, but also just gaiety and the joy of being alive, is part of what Baldwin admired in Shakespeare, and he saw it also in the blues. It's also significant that in that essay, Baldwin says, my first apprehension of Shakespeare came when I was living in France and speaking and thinking in French. The necessity of mastering a foreign language forced me into a new relationship to my own. It was also in France, therefore, I began to read the Bible again. And so we get the sense of humor, the sense of humanity, the idea of writing for specific people. And then we also get each person in his time or her time plays many parts, as we learn from As You Like It. The star-crossed lovers, John Faddis said, was the sound of pure love. That piece, we'll hear it in a minute. It's very complexly layered. And I think the idea of layering is important to all of this, as we saw with the stacked rhythms. It was originally star-crossed lovers, was called Pretty Girl or Pretty Little Girl, written for a Johnny Hodges alto saxophone date. In other words, it was Strayhorn, a gay man's love song to be sung on alto sax by a straight man, Johnny Hodges, for a pretty girl. Then it was repurposed by Duke Ellington and Strayhorn as a 14-year-old girl's call to teenage Romeo, Juliet's role played now by middle-aged Hodges on saxophone, which recalls that in Shakespeare's time, all female roles would have been played by men. In one 19th century American production, the role of Juliet was performed by Julius Caesar, as James Shapiro tells us, until the actor playing Othello complained that the buff bearded man as a girl was too distracting for him to do what he was supposed to do. But note here too, the idea of a forbidden marriage is at issue, Romeo and Juliet. So let's listen to part of this Star-Crossed Lovers. Here it is with Pretty Girl still as part of the title, Star-Crossed Lovers, written especially for Johnny Hodges. You see the score here, written by Billy Strayhorn. Here's another shot of Hodges. He translates this piece from what's written on the page into something much more passionate than just the notes themselves reveal. This is a, wait, before we hear it, here's this piece written for Hodges. His nickname in the band was the Rabbit. Mr. Rabbit had a habit, which is another story. But anyway, it's written for Rab, little girl, and star-crossed lovers and symbols at the top. And then watch, you can see that the time in the notes is very specific, but watch what Hodges does when he plays them. We'll just hear an excerpt of this before we go on. I recommend that you look that up online, Star-Crossed Lovers, and you can find the music as well on our website and look at how kind of mathematically precise the notes are and how much he brings to them. I want to play just a couple more pieces and then we'll come to Courtney playing her version of this. Here's the section about Hamlet, which Ellington introduces.
And now our next scene is taken from Hamlet. This is supposed to be parallel to the behavior of Hamlet during the time he was deceiving his stepfather. Actually, he was making believe that he was crazy. Of course, crazy didn't mean the same thing in those days as it does now. And this is titled Madness and Great Ones.
Yeah, well, before we get to that, Ellington's friend was Albert Murray, in whose novel Train Whistle Guitar, he has a character named Luzana Chali. And the narrator says, white folks used to say he was a crazy. But what they really meant or should have meant was that he was confusing to them. Because if they knew him well enough to call him crazy, they also had to know enough about him to realize that he wasn't foolhardy or even careless, not even what they wanted to mean when they used to call somebody biggity. Somehow or other, it was as if they respected him precisely because he didn't seem to care anything about him one way or the other. They certainly respected the fact that he wasn't going to take any foolishness off of them. And the black folks, Gasoline Point folks, also said he was crazy. This by way of glossing the use of the word crazy. But they meant their own meaning. Because when they said crazy, they really meant something else. They meant exactly the same thing as when they called him a fool. What they were talking about was something like poetic madness. And that was their way of saying that he was forever doing something unheard of, if not downright outrageous, doing the hell out of it, and not only getting away with whatever it was, but making you like it to boot. They almost always shook their heads laughing, even as they said it, and sometimes even before they said it. Oh, crazy Lou Zanichelli can sure play the fool out of that guitar. Oh, crazy Lou Zanichelli is a guitar playing fool, and a card playing fool, and a pistol packing fool, and a freight train snagging fool, and don't care who knows it. Here's Courtney commenting on the madness piece and her decision to play it at Snug Harbor.
I mean, the Madness and Great Ones is just such a great piece, like the way it is, the whole orchestration of it and the form. I decided just to, like, whatever parts were sort of in my mind in the moment, to play something off of that. And part of that was that rhythm that so since that comes back in the piece here and there, like, I always think of that as kind of like part of the madness part, but also I like a section of it when they do the rhythms that sounds that remind me of like the sonnet forms, like the iambic pentameter, and like it's like a swing rhythm, but it sounds like da 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 da. So that rhythm. So I didn't play like the notes that are in the piece. I just was thinking about that rhythm and the whole, you know, discussions that we had about the how the poetry or how the idea of the sonnet influenced the music. So those were two elements that I sort of riffed on from Madness and Great Ones, but also without approaching like the full piece, which I still hope to do at some point.
Yeah, the idea that an iambic pentameter swings, which came up in that earlier discussion, is something I'm not gonna forget soon, and I'm sure they had it in mind, don't you think, they bring it out. Were you also thinking of people who play that piece and trying to do something about them? Is it Clark on Madness?
I'm trying to remember, but
I can't remember either. But anyway, you were thinking about the rhythms and not necessarily about particular players in there.
Yeah, at that moment, I mean, listening to it, there's all kind of elements that could, you know, be like the main inspiration, but in that moment it was kind of more like a connection between the two other pieces just based on those two rhythms. But I do love about listening to the piece itself is just the whole, you know, the overall feature, the performance, the orchestration.
Okay, so here's the part of the Madness and Great Ones. And I've got to please go online and listen to Ellington play that. He's kind of enacting a kind of craziness at the piano. He's written a crazy part for the trumpet. It's very, very interesting to see that. Here's the third part of the suite that Courtney is going to play. And she's telling us how she felt about this section, which is about Kate in Taming of the Shrew. She describes what she's going to do here.
I spent a lot of time appreciating the music, how it's a sonnet in music form, and just, you know, like seeing what the form of it is. And then orchestration wise, it's very interesting because so some of the suite you have, like the one you heard opening up, is the full orchestra. It's like, and we talked about the bravado of it. And there's so much contrast throughout the suite. You have the full orchestra, then you'll have something like this where it's just four musicians. So you have the trombone and then accompanied by three saxophones. So I decided I just wanted to see how it is in just listening to the piano. So then you really just kind of hear the harmony without thinking about all the different like textures and stuff that's going on. So that's what this is. This is a sonnet. So just think about if you're familiar with that, which before this I definitely had to kind of look up what's the English sonnet. But what it does is it has these rhyming patterns, and at the end it has a couplet. And so musically, this is what this is doing. So at this point, I'll just go ahead and play it.
We'll hear it a little bit later. First, let's hear Ellington's version of this. He's written it for his trombone player, Quentin Jackson, whose nickname is Butter, and you see Butter's name at the top of this, of the score. And here he is playing it with a toilet plunger in the horn. It's just a very short sonnet, this one written out note for note.
We continue now with a sonnet. Quentin Jackson is a soloist, and I think the title is more or less self-explanatory. It's a sonnet for Sister Kate.
I'll show a little bit of it, the music. Cut it out now. Okay, I'm going to cut this a little short and just say it's fascinating that Ellington says that the title is self-explanatory. And I think part of what he means is that he sees a sisterhood in Kate, who's the title character of Taming of the Shrew. She's supposed to be this nasty woman, but he makes her something different. But here's a discussion of that piece.
And what this is.
Well, let me say first, this is Gene Howard talking about the role of Kate as presented in Ellington's music.
And what this is, it captures her melancholy of being, you know, outside the norm and not wanting to be just a tameable girl, but wanting love. And he just picked up on something in that play that most people don't pick up on, which I found very moving. If you think of it as an interpretation of, say, the Kate character, it's wonderful.
It's interesting. Also, a couple of weeks ago, one of the actors said, "We need women directors to do these plays, particularly Othello, so they can bring out some of the things that get muted otherwise." And it's interesting for Courtney to pull out this delicate part of the Ellington canon and to present that as delicate, strong key.
You might look for this book if you don't know it already, by Silvia Federici. It seems to me that Ellington's decision to show sympathy for Kate puts him in league with this, the radical feminist theorist who writes, women are accused of being unreasonable, vain, wild, wasteful. Especially blamed was the female tongue, seen as an instrument of insubordination. But the main female villain was the disobedient wife, who together with the scold, the witch, and the whore, was the favorite target of dramatists, popular writers, and moralists. In this sense, Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew was the manifesto of the age, and punishment of female insubordination to patriarchal authority was called for and celebrated in countless misogynist plays and tracts. And I asked Courtney, as I'm sitting there in my Airbnb with my ancestors in the background on the wall there, I asked her about the women and her decision to to choose women.
I wonder your decision to play Kate, Hamlet, Juliet. In other words, to make it 2/3 women. Yeah, and I wonder, and to, for this version, for now, we're going to leave out Othello. We're going to do it, you know, and we're going to leave out Puck. I mean, the other people would have might have chosen some. Does it make any? Did you make decisions that had something to do with your being a Black woman of a conscience and a care?
That's a great question. I mean, I actually didn't think about it. I mean, it might have been subconscious, but I was, I think the discussions hearing about the ones for signed up for Sister Kate and like how it was, like how you say it really represented a different side of her personality than people would talk about, like say in the play itself. I was interested in that, but I didn't actually notice that I focused on women. But I'm sure it was probably, you know, something. But I also like that in the suite, there's a good balance of, you know, like the different characters that are used for inspiration.
No, that's really interesting. I'll never, I had just read Taming of the Shrew, and you hear this kind of nasty, impossible person, and then they make her so tender, and they see, and it's as if Courtney, they decide to see another side of Lady Mac, and it also made me wonder about Mac the Knife, and here's Lady Mac. That was a hit that same year, Mac the
Knife.
Oh,
wow.
And they make that also the killer. They make him Louis Armstrong makes him very attractive and funny and as well as dangerous, and to say that she's got a little ragtime in her soul is really something great.
I want to wind up with Courtney now back at Snug Harbor in New Orleans about a month ago. The pictures are just pictures from her performances here on campus. And one of them has John Batiste, who's not involved directly here at all. But just to see different images of her, you'll see the names of the pieces that she's playing on the screen. And what she's doing is offering her own tone parallel now to Duke and Strayhorn and Shakespeare, a contemporary composer now working them out for piano. And she said, in some cases, she's playing pieces note for note. In other cases, she's improvising herself. And it's a three-part piece, 7 minutes long, and watch her work. And it's fascinating that she's in this club where people are sipping scotch and talking stuff and doing whatever they're doing. And here she is presenting Shakespeare and Ellington. She starts with Sister Kate, and then moves to Madness and Great Ones, Crazy, Hamlet, and then finishes with Juliet, the star-crossed lovers. First is Sonnet for Sister Kate. Wait, let me start again. Oh dear. Now she's moving toward madness and great ones. Now she's moving towards star-crossed lovers. These are the pictures that I was meaning to show you, but they just didn't work out that way. There's Jonathan Batiste. By the way, he reached in the piano to compete with her. And she laughed and said, "Oh yeah, don't look out now." She reached inside and played it inside the piano as well. And so if we ask ourselves, what was the statement here? What was the seminar intending to teach us? I think part of it can be put this way, that while the big band era in jazz was over, neither the term big band or jazz quite suited what Ellington and Strayhorn and their players were doing as artists. They were doing jazz, but they were attempting more than that. They were what's usually associated under that banner. They were attempting what Shakespeare was attempting, to use their evolving artistic language to express, celebrate, criticize the drama of being alive on earth, to capture the strange, irregular rhythm of life, its fun and foolishness, its notes and tricks. That these artists were not translating or adapting Shakespeare into music was part of their point. They weren't soundtracking Shakespeare. They were recreating Shakespearean scenes and themes in modern contemporary terms. They were harlemizing Shakespeare's characters and scenes to offer fresh Black readings for contemporary audiences who might not recognize Lady Macbeth, but who knew Lady Mac and Hank Sank. They wanted to tell a Black story that was also somehow the story. They were doing what Langston Hughes was trying to do, as he called a book of his, Shakespeare, in Harlem, trying to translate or parallel the work now in a Black idiom. Their point, I think, was that although as Black Americans, their bodies had been hemmed in and brutalized. I'm having a little trouble reading my own screen here with the different boxes that come up. That there is a celebration of the body. There's a swagger in the music in spite of all the violence. They were influenced by the jazz tradition, but by world musics too. Emphatically by the French impressionists that Strayhorn loved, but they reveled in a rich mix of influences. And here, moving beyond literature, they claimed an influence by literature too. Shakespeare's forms and characters and scenes could tell their story. They not only sat with Shakespeare and he winced not, they danced with Shakespeare and he danced back. There's something quite significant, quite festive, and also slightly mocking in this work. Somehow Duke and Strayhorn are with Puck, and with the idea of the jester, the fool, as the wisest observer from the periphery. And this work offers new sideline perspectives on all the characters. It's notable that every one of the plays here is a love story, even Macbeth. And I think that one of the points here is that there's a definition of love, as Baldwin was saying. So let's let the last word go to Courtney. I asked her, you know, what's next? Now that you've done this, are you going to work on it some more?
Think about what it means to learn the piece. There's so much into just learning and appreciating the piece, like appreciating as a listener, appreciating as a performer, like getting to perform it. And there's just so many angles, like what one would do if they were to write a piece or come up with another project inspired by it. There's just so many angles to come from. It could come from just how do you think about different poetic forms and music. There's that inspiration. There's thinking about the highlighting of the different members of the orchestra. There's like the orchestration of something like Madness and Great Ones. There's so many angles to come at from if one were to, like, say a composer was to write a piece inspired by this, or if a writer was going to write words inspired by thinking about Ellington and Strayhorn interpreting Shakespeare. So I don't know, I guess my main thing is just like each time I look at it, I'm like, oh wow, there's a different angle. It's just so much richness in it. So that's what's really exciting about continually studying this piece, I guess.
What's the next step? Is your piece finished, you think, or is there a next version, or I guess we'll have to wait and see?
Yeah, I hope. I mean, I feel like in studying it, I just want to, you know, grow as a composer from it, like from studying the piece, just looking at all the different elements that go into it and, you know, appreciating this piece, but thinking of like how, you know, how would I, you know, from what I've been learning, what I continue learning from this piece, like how would I use that in a different situation, whether it's like inspiration from other poetry or plays, and, you know, how music and text can inform one another.
Wait, why don't we leave it at that? Thank you very much for your attention tonight.
Thank you so much, Bob. This was a really illuminating talk on the relationship between language and music. I think particularly interesting for some of our listeners from the fellows from the Institute for Ideas and Imagination who work across disciplines and who I'm sure were stimulated by the way that you engage with different media and art forms. For my part, I just want to say how astounded I was at how attuned you are to the musicality of language. And the pieces that you played were absolutely gorgeous. Perhaps as we're waiting for a participant to ask a question, I'm going to try to ask, like, I have a big question, if it's okay. And maybe you won't like it. Maybe you won't like it. You said earlier in your presentation that you don't like making everything a Black person makes as, you know, a political statement, and I understand that. But from your talk, there does seem to be a special kind of affinity or connection of African Americans to Shakespeare, at least in the way that everything builds up as to me as a listener. So I just wanted to know if you could say a little bit more about how Shakespeare may relate more particularly to the African American experience of race, slavery, freedom, battle for equal rights. And I know, like, on the one hand, right, we have Baldwin saying, right, this is a way to engage with the greatest poets of the English language. Well, that's one thing. You know, later on at the conclusion of your talk, right, it's like about the drama of being alive on earth. But I'm just wondering if there's, you know, if there's something more. And particularly I'm thinking about this because I find the title of your book so compelling and intriguing and, you know, something that one wants to play with around a little bit more. It's called antagonistic cooperation, which is very different from inspiration, which is very different from emulation or influence. And so, right, with this notion of working with and working against. So voila, so and you also mentioned, and this is the last part, but like, you also mentioned that you're still in search of a title and a thesis. And so I wonder, voila, how this all kind of wraps up. And I apologize, that was a really big question.
This is what has kept me up at night since I agreed to do this. I tell you, I'm haunted by a short story by Ralph Ellison, in which it called It Always Breaks Out, in which the character says, what do you mean? Everything the Negro does is political. And this is a white racist saying that. And the other, the kind of liberal Northern white journalists say, oh goodness, that can't be right. Don't say that. And he says, yeah. And there's this, as a typical Ellison, Ralph Ellison, there's a certain amount of truth in what he's saying. And he goes on to say, look, if a Black person, he says a Negro, buys a foreign car, it's political. If he decides not to go to the Black school, but to another school, that's political. If he starts to read William Faulkner and love it, and he also, as I recall it, I hadn't thought of it this way. He says if he claims to love Shakespeare, that's political. And what Ellison means, of course, is that if you step out of the straitjacket of language or the prison house of behavior that's set for you as an oppressed person, then it's political, then it's a challenge. And so there's a sense in which he's right, everything that everybody does is political. And for a Black person living in America particularly, is that true? But it's what I mean when I say I don't like that is that I read that when Black actors would read sections of Shakespeare at the Apollo Theater in the early part of the 20th century, members of the audience would respond. They would know, neither a borrower nor a lender be. They would say, each man in his time plays many parts, mewling and puking in his mother. And Ira Aldridge talks about the shock of seeing how, not just politically speaking, but how otherwise Shakespeare's language was woven into the fabric of everyday life. And my mother, I'm sure, did not know she was quoting Polonius. And she didn't know to thine own self be true, and things like that. But somehow it worked its way in beyond any question of politics. And yet, if we come back to politics again, I think Douglass's quest for his humanity, where he says, "You've seen how a man can be made into a slave. Now I'll show you how a slave can be made into a man." I think part of that process comes from looking at Julius Caesar and the variety of characters there, identifying with the characters in All's Well Who Ends Well, looking at Othello's plight, seeing the varieties of human experience, I think helped Douglass put together his sense of who he was. And so it's political in that, I guess, capital P sense of the word, in which you realize your citizenship in this world as a member of the polis, as a member of the community, through watching Shakespeare. I asked Gene Howard and James Shapiro and others about Shakespeare and freedom. And they said, well, he didn't tend to talk about freedom explicitly. And he was wary of liberty, meaning excessive, undisciplined willfulness and carelessness and cruelty. But yet the theme of freedom comes through, because the poetry makes it seems like he can do anything. He can tell you, shall I compare thee to a summer's day? He can make you feel so many different ways that the sense of freedom is very much there.
Bob?
Yeah, I could say more, but I think that's some of what I'm thinking about this.
No, but thank you. I realized that there was a question that came through in the chat, and so I want to make sure that I'm a good moderator. from a friend of ours, Jake Lamar, dear Professor O'Mealy, this was off the charts, brilliant, absolutely sublime. Thank you. But he does have a question. Could you please tell the story of how the genius Ellington was cheated out of a Pulitzer Prize?
Well, first, a shout out to my dear, brilliant novelist, Jake Lamar, whose work is now available in English and who's on his way to streaking to further and further heights. So thanks for being here, Jake. In 1969, I believe it was, the Pulitzer Prize Committee had Ellington's name as a nominee, and then they declined to give him the Pulitzer Prize. And Ellington, he had a slightly mocking way about him. But when he was asked by a reporter, what do you think about it? You didn't get the Pulitzer Prize? And Ellington said, oh, no, they were doing me a great favor. He was 70 that year. And he said, they didn't want to spoil me with this prize while I was still so very young. So I appreciate their declining to embarrass me by something like that. And I love that story. And then I love Ralph Ellison's essay, which I suggest people look up, called Homage to Duke Ellington. He says Ellington's answer there was something like the answer that the slaves gave when they were watching a dance class being held by the whites in their house. The children are learning it from the dancing master. And meanwhile, the slaves are doing a slightly mocking version of what they're seeing being done in this educated way. And he says, then the whites responding in the house, thinking they're being flattered, are dancing a comment back to the blacks. He said, and then Ellison says, while the blacks danced out their mocking reply. And that sort of pattern, I think, is very revealing about American culture, that we look at ballet and we think we can do something better. We listen to Tchaikovsky and we listen to whatever it is, to Beethoven, and we think we can make it more swinging than they ever did before. So that the humor is not just derisive or self-indulgent, but there's an engine of creativity that says, oh yeah, I bet you I can do ballet with no shoes on, or I bet you I can do ballet and make it work to a church song. And so there's Ellington being very mocking, but Ellington also being super creative.
I like that. Unfortunately, I think I also have to be a little bit mindful of time, and I'm sure that maybe people will reach out to you directly with follow-up questions on this talk. I just want to pick up one quotation. You had so many lovely quotations in your talk, but one by Martin Luther King on jazz as a musical form that is triumphant and leaving people with a new sense of hope. And that gives me the opportunity to thank you for what you gave us today, which I feel is really a new sense of awareness to art and reality. It was almost like a sensory awakening. It was really lovely. Your talk was such sweet thunder. So thank you, Bob. Thank you very much. Perhaps for our viewers, our next event of Entre Nous will be on April 12th at the American Library. It will be a conversation between Columbia professors Matthew Jones and Chris Wiggins about their new book called How Data Happened, A History from the Age of Reason to the Age of Algorithms, which explores the ways in which data has long been used as a tool and a weapon in arguing for what is true, as well as a means of rearranging or defending power. So voilà. Merci beaucoup, Bob.
Merci.
À bientôt. I'm back to Paris. Thank you, everybody.